I've come to talk with you again, because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked along narrow streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar to the cold and damp, when my eyes were stared by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing songs that voices never share. No one dared disturb the sound of silence. Fools that I do not know, silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words that I might teach you, take my arms that I might reach you. But my words like silent raindrops fell, echoing the wells of silence. The people bowed and prayed to the neon god they made, and the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was forming. And the sign said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls, the tenement halls, whispering
silence. Good evening, and we want to welcome parents, administrators, teachers, and friends. My name is Ted Meyer. I teach English and Avid at Sierra Vista High School. This evening, our goal is to illustrate for you the importance and the power of silence, but more importantly, our own voices. We challenge you this evening, please think. Think deeply about your life, your parents' lives, everyone in their past, everyone you're going to meet in your future. And please, silence your cell phones. Listen to the following stories of oppression. Respect the hard work that these fine young youth, who with virtually no theater experience, will create magic for you this evening. And please remember, as in theater, silence is golden. Thank you.
Gracias. Okay. Gracias por estar aquí con nosotros esta noche. Y a los padres que están, muchísimas gracias. A Miss White. A todos los maestros que están, a Miss Carpenter. Y a todos los padres. Gracias, gracias, gracias. Sierra Vista High School is a wonderful school. We do everything we can to make a safe campus and to make our campus bully-free. And we got this idea to do a tour of oppression, our stories of oppression, because we don't ever want to lose that at Sierra Vista High School. And so you're going to see tonight a wide array of stories. Some of them might deeply touch your heart, and you might even think, oh my gosh, this is really strong. But all of our students have spoken from their hearts, and they're telling their stories to you. So honestly and sincerely, we thank you so much for being here. Gracias.
And now our two MCs for the evening, Mr. Danny Barrasio and Ms. Gabby Ortega. Please welcome Ms. Gabby Tapia. They'll be your MCs for this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Meyer and Ms. Shree. Welcome, everybody, to the first ever Stories of Oppression. Tonight, you will encounter different forms of oppression that our society in everyday lives. Some of these acts of oppression are easy to spot, and others will go unnoticed. I ask you to please honor all these seniors who worked hard to write their monologues. Thank you, and I pass it on to Gabby.
Again, and thank you for being here. Amongst tonight's topics are oppression of post-traumatic stress disorder patients, the homeless, body image, parental oppression, animal abuse, oppression of undocumented students, the Vietnamese, immigrants, the oppression of tattooing, media's oppression on pro athletes, and oppression of abusive relationships and oppression of Native Americans. These students tonight that are performing got the opportunity to explore these topics through their research paper. And so once again, we will ask you to please silence your cell phones in respect of them. So thank you. First and foremost, we have Brayan Torres, who did his research paper on the effects of post-traumatic stress disorder on the life of veterans. So please help me welcome Brayan Torres to the stage.
I can't see him. Find any possible way to avoid this uncontrollable anxiety and fear. I don't even feel like myself anymore. They said I would be prepared for such situations, and I was, just not mentally. When I came back from the war, I couldn't wait to see my little brother, to see how much he had grown, to hug him, my only brother. I promised him I'd spend more time with him through the letters I sent him. It's just that. I don't know how to tell him. He's just a kid. My parents know, my friends know, but he doesn't. Every time he wants me to play with him, it's to play Xbox. I like to play Xbox. It's just that. He wants me to play this game with him. This game of Call of Duty. I heard him talking on the microphone with his friends, saying how his brother's a soldier, and he'll probably be very good at that game. But this isn't a game. I held my friend Sean on my arms as he screamed and screamed for his life with his left arm blown off. Bombs were going off all around us, and yet the only thing I could hear is his voice erupting like a volcano. I couldn't say anything. I couldn't do anything. And now he lives without an arm. And I can hardly sleep. Fears of dreaming and reliving that event, waking up drenched in sweat, breathing heavily. And now, I don't even cut my hair because in the military, I had to cut it every single week. And now, I live with post-traumatic stress disorder. And I want to tell my brother, but I've always been his role model, and telling him would make me look weak. Then, he wouldn't have a good role model. I can't go to the park. I can't go to the theater. I can't go to the store. I can barely walk out my front door without fears of making it back home safely again. All I want to do is spend time with my little brother.
Brayan. Okay, up next is Carlos Navarrete, who can relate in some ways to the homeless and wants to show us what life as a homeless can be like. Please welcome Carlos Navarrete to the stage.
Place to sleep here on the grass. Someone threw out some old blankets that kept me warm. Sometimes I can't find a place to sleep or blankets to cover me. I just like to go to the park. It's nice and safe there. I like to sleep on the green bench. But the police always kicks me out. They don't like me there. They don't want me there. Another day, waking up in the streets in downtown Los Angeles. The people are going to work. They are all wearing their suits and their ties. Some of them look at me like if I was dirty or crazy. Others just turn away, as if they were afraid to look at me in the eyes. They never look at me in the eyes. Are they afraid of what they might see in themselves? I used to have a home. I had a family. I had an education. I wanted to be a doctor or a firefighter. I wanted to help people. I wanted to save lives. I love people. Then I went to war. I was fighting for my country, for your country, for our country. But I got shot. They came and got me. They put me in a stretcher. They took me to a hospital. It was a long time. In a bed. On my own. Hanging on to life. By a needle in my arm. Yo, check this out, yo. Yo quisiera explicarles y decirles tantas cosas que se convirtieron en el murciélago mis mariposas, que la vida que tenía llenaron de espinas. Yo recuerdo y es una serpiente venenosa que me sigue, que me dice, Carlos, que para atrás no mire, que en el mundo hay mucha gente, espera que algún día te cuiden. La vida que tenías fue una zona de combate, lo hirieron y hoy entre la muerte se debate. ¿Sí? A homeless person can have talent. But people don't take a second, don't take a moment to ask, why are you homeless? What are you feeling? May I help you? No one cares. I want a better life. I want dreams. People say that I don't have an opinion because I don't own anything. That I'm nobody. That I am where I am because I want to be here. They might think that I'm a druggie, that I'm a mental case. But the truth is that I need to feed myself. I'm hungry this morning.
Sir!
Can you spare some change? Thank you.
Now, Karla Salmeron will be doing her monologue on body image. The point that she wants to get across is that we should all be happy with the way that our bodies look. So please welcome Karla Salmeron to the stage.
I look at all the photos in the magazine. And I see all the pretty girls with the perfect body. And then? And then I look at myself in the mirror, getting up every day, trying to transform myself, covering my face with tons of makeup, having trouble to choose my clothes, just to cover my fat body. Thinking about how to confront those people. Those people who whisper to each other. Look at the fat girl. She's sweet, but she thinks she's hot. Thinking about how to confront those people who are always rejecting me for the way I look to them. Are they asking me if I'm not ashamed to go outside? They always ask me the same questions. But I never give them an answer. An answer. I just can't give them an answer. I just look at them and they start crying. But today, I woke up. I didn't try to transform myself. I went out being who I am. Today I want to confront those people. Today I will give them an answer. To those people who ask me if I'm not ashamed to go outside, I will answer. That today, I'm not ashamed and they're afraid to go outside. I feel great to go outside and show everyone the real me. But today, I also want them to answer me. I demand to those people to answer me. Who do they think they are? To judge me just because they think I'm fat. Just because I don't fit the many perfect body image. Who are they to make me feel less? Who am I to believe them?
That we should all be happy with who we are. Next, the next monologue is about the pressure that parents put on their kids. Let's welcome Mario Benitez to the stage.
I'm sorry, Mom and Dad. I just can't take any longer. I just hate the fact that you made me become something I just didn't want to be. But I'm tired of you. I'm tired of all the stuff you made me do without me. I'm tired. But ask yourself, why did my parents force me to become who I am right now? Why? Every day they asked me, how was I in school, about grades and about tests. And every single time I had her answer their stupid questions, never did they ask me about who I talked, if I needed any, or if I even had a crush on a girl. Was I an animal? Did I have no feelings? And they forced me to become this doctor. But how can I be a doctor if I don't like it? I always ask myself, finally, my dad, why can't you guys accept my true love profession? My profession, I'm a teacher, and to teach people who want to be a teacher in the future. For now, I stand here in front of your mother, your life hanging, and your son's operating table. Or should I, your son, let you live after all the hardships you made me go through? I'm sorry, man. I'm just back to you.
Thank you, Mario. Up next is Elizabeth, who will be enacting life as an abused animal. Please welcome Elizabeth to the stage. Showing us what life is like being an abused animal. So up next we have Alejandra Castillo, who will be presenting on undocumented students. She did her research paper on undocumented students because not only can she relate, but she also wants to share her love and passion for immigrant activism. Please welcome Alejandra Castillo to the stage.
Learning my letters.
¿Cómo le puedo decir that everything you are teaching me, I already know? I learned it in Mexico. But you don't let me speak. You shut me up. I can't say anything if it isn't in English. Slowly, you are killing my language and my culture. You don't understand that my culture does not have an off switch. I just can't stop being who I am to be what you call an American. Because Spanish is in my soul. Está aquí en mi alma. And as you call gold, ni un sonido, ni un suspiro, ni un eco se escuchó. I never hear my name. I hear Alex and Alexandra and Alondra, but never Alejandra. Just Alejandra. I tried to correct you. Miss, it's Alejandra. Just Alejandra. But you don't understand that it's just Alejandra. Simplemente Alejandra. That's the name that stares back at me as I mail my applications. The same nine letters with those nine empty digits under it. The social security number that is forever empty. And Miss Teacher telling me that I am not an American. I can remember her till this day as I'm walking out of the interview, and the receptionist tells me that there were some irregularities with my application. Bull! There are irregularities within the government that strips children of their culture, and there are irregularities within the government that cause human beings, illegal aliens. Pero ahora sí puedo hablar inglés y español. Now I can speak English and Spanish. Y aún sigo siendo Alejandra. Simplemente Alejandra.
It's not a crime, it's art. Art. Let me say that one more time. It's art. Lines and colors put together That's what most people think it is. But those lines and colors that are put together came from somewhere. They have a story. Beautiful. An expression. It has a meaning. If you guys would take that extra second and look deeper into it, there's a possible chance that you will relate to it. You can find a communication with it. It can line up your day and your mood. Before you take that time to look at it, don't judge it and don't criticize it. To society, it's vandalism. To society, I'm a criminal. But in reality,
we're artists.
Thank you.
Marie, and like they said, please feel welcome to go look at their art after the show has ended. Okay, up next we have Angel No, who will be presenting on the oppression of the Vietnamese. She wanted to exemplify some of the stereotypes that she faced as she came into this country and the stereotypes that Vietnam faces. So please welcome Angel to the stage.
What is oppression?
Let me tell you. I remember when I first came to this country, people looked at me.
Made where?
I think to myself, I should take a picture, you know? How can it last longer?
What kind of look is this? Unhuman? I'm an alien or something? Is it because of how I look different? The way I judge Holly?
Shh!
Calling me a beggar?
Any question on my mind? Then I went to school.
And no kids! Some looked at me. I laughed.
The same story begins again.
What it is? Just because I came from a poor country doesn't mean I dress poorly.
Yeah, sure.
I don't speak English. I have accent. Is it my fault? Is it my eyes? Are my eyes mom? Do you think I can see you? Do you see my Chinese? Chinita?
Let me tell you,
the Chinese invaded my country, Vietnam.
We should not oppress you. Yeah,
right? Go ahead and judge me, but you don't know what I'm really like.
Come on, walk in my shoes and go through the path that I have given.
It wasn't my choice.
Why?
Why?
We have to leave our country to look for a new life.
But it doesn't mean we can't compare to you. Are we not as good as you?
I sometimes just
want to jump over the bridge, stand in front of you, take a look, who died or whatever. Wherever, I can escape from this crazy world.
Why would I?
Yes, I can overcome depression like anybody else in the world. I can show them I can do better in a new life, in a new country. Yes, I can.
I went to Vietnam last summer. I went back to Vietnam. I went back to my country.
That poor country, filled with rice fields and farmers. Undeveloped country. And people with eating dog in the street.
But wait, what did I see here? a modern city. International bank, freeway, theaters, Starbucks, Burger King. Walking down the street, walking their dogs, not eating their dogs. I see Ferrari, not bicycle. I see BMW, Mercedes, not mules. But we're living a long time ago. A lot of things to be turned into home. Wait, home? Which place is home? Is or West, Vietnam, or America. Home is where all my love runs out. In my home, all people are loved.
Thank you, Angel.
You know, is it okay if we stop for 1 minute so we can talk about you? I'll be right back.
Well, Miss Vita is doing that. I want to share a little bit about Angel. I got to meet her through this performance, and I just want to say that I found out that she came to America about a year and a half ago, and I felt like she was here longer. I felt like maybe she came to elementary here because I thought that she spoke very well and she just fit like so well into here, so I just wanted to share that about Angel. So now that Ms. Fried is back, let's welcome Robert Duenas to the stage, who will be presenting on the difficulties of an immigrant family.
I used to wake up every morning to work in the fields. Yeah, it was hard work, and I loved it. I love the smell of corn. I love to hacer la cosecha. I was proud of it, actually. I would go home late at night just to be with my family. We would sit outside and tell each other our stories. I love our stories. Then one day, the land went dry. We had no harvest. We were selling corn. I decided to be Mexico and travel a long road to the U.S. to find a better future. We packed our things and made the trip. Me, my wife, my baby. As we neared the border, we held hands and made it across. As I carried my baby along with me. Yeah, I got a job near a factory near San Diego. My wife, she got a job cleaning someone's house. We lived in a little apartment. We didn't go outside much anymore. But we still told our stories. So that day, the migrant raided a house where my wife worked. I came home that night, and there was my baby lying on the floor. The babysitter left her alone. She got tired of waiting for my wife. I picked up my baby and held her close to me.
Every night,
I will work and go to a border. I will go there with my baby and press her little lips through a fence where my wife will breastfeed her. A fence? That separates two countries and one family. Until one night, light shined on us. Sirens roared and roared. I told my wife to run and run. I held my baby and ran too. She ran north. I ran south. Now it's 5 years later. My baby drinks milk out of a glass. And I send money to Mexico every week just for her. But I stay here, waiting for my wife to come home.
Thank you, Robert. So next we have Leonor Garnica, who will be presenting on tattoos. So at times, people judge those with tattoos even before they get to meet them. But today, Leonor wants to challenge you to get to know the person and the story behind the tattoos before you make up your mind about them. So please welcome Leonor to the stage.
What are you looking at? Yeah, I know you're looking at me. You don't have to say anything. I already know. I see that look so many times before, it's not even funny anymore. Everybody acts like I'm some kind of delinquent. They act like I've been in a gang, do drugs, and been in and out of jail all my life. That I'm some irresponsible adult that didn't finish school and could care less about the world around me. Yet, the society that I live in judges me. Judges me for the ink on my arms. See here? There's no such thing as a happy ending. The words that my mother said when she left my dad. I was only 7. The footprint is the footprint of my baby. He died. He was born with a defect that caused him to die being only days old. Chasing cars. The song that my fiance played when he asked me to marry him. He was shot in a drive-by, trying to get to the hospital. He died at the scene. My life has been hard, and my body shows the pain that I have to overcome every day of my life. Like the society that judges me. But I'm not ashamed of it, not at all. I'm forced to cover. I'm going to a job interview. I'm forced to cover even with my own family. This is what society wants me to be, but I'm not.
We all know the power that the media has on our decisions and thoughts of others. Up next, Luis Garcia wants to demonstrate the effects that media has on athletes. Please welcome Luis to the stage.
Those Saturday Night Lights changed my entire life. I never imagined myself leaving my hometown in Southern California, the same place you guys are in, and much less did I imagine myself making an impact in life. But now, I found myself in the pedestal atop of the country doing what I love, and that is playing football. I might have been the biggest kid in high school, but never did I picture myself traveling across the country to play ball in Gator Country. To some, Football might just be an overpaid career. A game that catches only the attention of football fans and couch potatoes. But to me, it was a dream come true. It gave me the reason to believe that I could escape poverty that I much desired. And I rose quickly to the shine and fame on top of the country. My teammates helped me get there. My family supported me there. My fans admired me there. The reporters and the media, well, it's funny how quickly it pushed me off that same pedestal. Well, according to them, I had a non-existent girlfriend. According to them, I had phone conversations with someone non-existent on the other line. I tried presenting my side of the story, the truth. But one man's voice will always be outnumbered by thousands of reporters. ESPN criticized me for my mistakes that were never committed. I was never given the chance to shine in the NFL. Years of possible success thrown away due to rumors. Money blown away due to gossip. My passion in life yanked right out of my heart. 20 years later, I found myself in this two-bedroom apartment back in Southern California. I'm sitting bankrupt without even a penny to feed me and my two kids. It's just hard to believe how deep down they brought me into this abyss. But now I see how life really is. I have a minimum paid job, having to travel from point A to point B by waiting at the bus stop. Yeah, they were there to see me shine in that football field back in the University of Florida. The main highlight that you guys might have seen in ESPN was that gossip, that non-existent story. Yeah, that story of the Heisman winning Gator turning into a lifetime failure.
Thank you, Louis. Next, we have Kimberly Castellan. She wrote her paper on the different types of relationships. But tonight, she will be focusing on abusive relationships. Through this, she wants to show that anyone can overcome any obstacles. So please welcome Kimberly to the stage.
The first time I ever wished that I would just die. I laid on the ground, naked and cold. My brother outside, tied up in a chair. But I just kept screaming out, "Help! Please, help!" No one came to my rescue. That night my parents worked late, no one to help me. I screamed and I cried till my lungs couldn't no more. A night replaced in my head. Over and over again. More often now that I'm 33, I once fell in love with a man. He helped me overcome my fears, but now he's the man that's hurting me. Did he stop loving me? Did he stop caring? Was it all a lie? Because all I hear out of his lips is, "I don't trust you no more. You didn't deserve anything I gave you," with another punch over my face. And I lay here once again screaming, "Stop! Stop! Please! I'm sorry! I don't even know why I was apologizing. Just because it was one more night. One more night that I didn't want to sleep with him. One more night." One more night that I just want to sleep with him. And it was one of those nights that he would rather beat me than to force himself on me. But lying on the ground, I just knew that I would rather die than live one more day like this. I cried and I screamed and I begged him to stop. He stops and apologizes. He tells me that he's sorry and he won't do it again. And in my head, I wanted to believe him, but I just can't anymore. I've heard those exact words so many times. I've heard those exact words so many times. but I just can't seem to walk out that door. I don't know, I just can't leave him. Is it because he told me he would kill himself if I did? And somewhere deep down, I might just care about what happens to this man. But then he starts to blame me. That maybe if I did what he wanted me to do, he wouldn't have to react this way. That maybe if I stopped asking for money, or stopped bugging him about letting me work, he wouldn't find a need to beat me. Or maybe if I showed that I loved him, that maybe he wouldn't force me to sleep with him. But how could you love someone who can't be patient with you? Love someone who's controlling your life when he's the one who knows what you have faced at the age of 6. Should I pack my things and leave? Will he even miss me? Will he hurt himself or someone else I love? When will this pain ever end? Thank you.
For sharing a topic that is so sensitive. So now, as our trailblazer himself, Danny Barocio, will be presenting on the different stereotypes of Native Americans face. He was inspired to do his research paper on Native Americans by Ms. Seward and Mr. Coletta, his previous history teachers. So please welcome Danny Barocio to the stage.
Yes, I enjoy life. It was just like yesterday, when I last saw my wife, my friends, my family. I was a leader, a warrior, a husband. It was a nice spring day. The sun was shining over the mountaintops of the Dakotas. I was farming and preparing food for my wife and small community. When from the corner of my eye, I saw a figure on a horse. I thought it was just one of my own men. I continued farming. But then, when I turned around again, I saw hundreds and hundreds of men heading towards my village. I knew that these men came to kill us. I panicked. I yelled at my wife, "Run! Grab my son!" I knew that these men would wipe us out. But then, I heard this noise. This noise that haunts me. BAM! BAM! The shots that killed many innocent people, men, women, children, dead, lifeless. I didn't know what to do. I was shocked, paralyzed. Could this be really happening? But then I saw a man. Now, I will never forget this man. A man on a horse heading towards my wife with a gun. I yelled at her, "Run! Run for your life!" She looked at me, and then she was shot. She laid there, lifeless, dead. I didn't know what to do. But then, another man hit me on the head. I passed out for a while. When I woke up, I saw that my once beautiful village lay to ruins. Could this really be happening? The scene, the smell of death was overwhelming and powerful. Fire engulfed my whole village. It was all gone. But then, I didn't know what to do. I just stood there. I knew I had to solve this problem. I didn't know how. I quickly got up and rushed to go see my wife. Lifeless, dead. I cried. I held her hand. But then, in the corner of my ear, I heard a cry. It was my baby son. He was still alive. I quickly got up and rushed to pick him up. I didn't know where we would go, nor where the safest place was. I knew that these men would come again, and we would come again with greater armies. We had a treaty with the white men. Look what they did. I realize now that every Indian is a target. They took our land, they took our culture, they took our language, they took our children. Who are we now? Are we the savages, or are they the savages?
Okay, one last introduction for our final evening. We have Ms. Tapia. Gabby Tapia is gonna tell you about her art. We did want to leave you this evening with a lot of oppression, a lot of negative thoughts, and a lot of gloom and doom. So we want to leave you some words of hope and inspiration from Gabby Tapia. She did her topic on prophetic art, which I thought was great because I didn't know what prophetic art was. So when she told me about her project, I thought, what a great way to end our evening. So we can leave tonight rejoicing in our own freedoms, in our own choices, in our own voices. So before I leave this evening, I want to hand it off to Ms. Gabby Tapia, who's going to talk to you about her prophetic art. Thank you.
Just give me one moment to get my beanie. Okay, so tonight, obviously, we spoke about a lot of oppression, and we didn't just want to bring these topics up to you guys. We wanted to spark in you guys a desire to want to change, to stop the oppression. And I researched a little bit on stopping oppression as a community, and the first step is to realize that there is oppression, to notice the different types of oppression. So by being here today, you guys have taken that first step in trying to notice the oppression that is in our society. So this, the top painting shows just a little bit of oppression. We see a woman who's in tears and is being silenced. We see a homeless person and with a sign saying that I'm not a statistic, I'm a human being. Then you see a college and you see a fence made up of money. That fence represents the Social Security and being undocumented. It keeps students who are great in school. It prevents them from going to college. You also see a door and a gay couple. People are oppressed, people judge them. That's why they don't come out, because they feel like they're gonna be judged and hurt. So we just encourage you tonight to be able to notice the oppressions and to want to stand up and to be able to catch yourself in those thoughts, in those judgmental thoughts. So that's the second step, acknowledging that you're judging others and acknowledging that you have to do something about it. So on the lower painting, I have a group, and they form a heart. And so what tonight we're asking you guys as a group is to go out into our society and to form a heart, to form a society that welcomes everybody. And obviously, judgment isn't going to end overnight, but what small act is what it takes. You never know what that person is going through, and by showing them an act of kindness, you could do so much. So that is what my paintings represent, and I hope that you guys enjoyed tonight. Now, please help me welcome all the actors back to the stage. So once again, let's welcome Brayan, Torres, Carlos Navarrete, Karla Salmeron, Mario Benitez, Elizabeth Alejandra Castillo, Marie Paredes, Joseph Aguilar, Angel No, Robert Duenas, Leonor Garnica, Luis Garcia, Kimberly Castellan, and Danny Barroso to the stage.
I'd like to thank you all for attending tonight. With your support, you made our dreams come true. You listened to us, listened to our voices. And it was a pleasure performing for you all. I was lucky enough to work with all these great seniors. And it was a privilege and an honor. I also want to thank all of middle school for letting us provide with a stage, Mr. Novelet, Ms. Humble, Mario Ortiz. I'd like to thank our film, our food, our wonderful parents that brought the food. Everyone, our teacher advisors, Mr. Meyer, Ms. Seward, Ms. Reed, Ms. White, I want to thank you tonight for coming and joining us. Teachers from Sierra Vista, thank you for coming tonight. This concludes our night. Thank you for coming.
We're all three going to speak for just 1 second. Danny Barroso put this whole thing together. And he's not easy. He never let us go home at night. He said, one more practice. And we did one more practice. And Gabby Tapia came to us like a blessing to be able to put it all together. And every single actor and actress and our two filmers and our pianist and our great videographer, thank you so much. I want to say thank you to all of them. They're such wonderful students to work with. Every little advice you gave them, they just did it. It was like a dream come true to work with these kids, and I've worked with them in other ways. And believe me, this is the best way to work with kids like this. So I really enjoyed it, and it was great, great fun. Thank you very much.
This is Common Core at its best, coming the first time.
I just want to say one final word. Rarely do I have the pleasure of meeting people like these people. I mean, I've had the joy of having these students in my avid and English class, but I just want to say thank you all for bringing back a passion inside me for teaching. Like, seeing you out here and doing your amazing things, this is what gives us teachers joy. It gives us hope. It gives us faith. And you all are incredible, incredible individuals. And I wish you all the best as you travel after high school, graduation, and everything. And thank you, and God bless, and thank you.
I'll state my case, which I'm certain Oh, we also have a wall of remembrance back there with the graffiti art. So if you guys want to join in and make your own.